Ladies and gentlemen, the next session is The Impact on Thailand and CLMV of Rebalancing in China by Dr. Supachai Panitchpak, Secretary General, the United Nations Conference on Trade and Development. The Q&A session will run by Dr. Chua, Head of Emerging Asia Economics, Bank of America, Merrill Lynch. Please welcome Dr. Supachai and Dr. Chua Hakbin on stage to begin their session. Thank you.
Thank you for joining us for the session. My name is Hakbin. I'm the ASEAN economist. We'll be focusing on the impact on Thailand and Laos, Vietnam, Myanmar, Cambodia from the rebalancing in China. We're honored here to have Dr. Supachai, Secretary General of the UNCTAD. Dr. Supachai, I think, brings an expertise of both being a former policymaker. He was a former Deputy Prime Minister in 1992, trade negotiator, as well as being an economist and an academic. He has published widely on China, on trade, as well as on globalization. So I think we will have the session with Dr. Supachai kicking off with a few comments, and then I think we can open up with Q&A. And I'll start with a few questions, but he's kindly agreed to take some questions as well from the audience. Thank you. Yeah, perhaps.
Thank you for the introduction, Hakbin. Let me say a few words by way of introducing our session so that you would know a little bit more how I stand when we discuss the rebalancing process that is taking place in China and the impact on the rest of Southeast Asia, particularly for Thailand and the CLMV countries. Now, I just came from Europe yesterday. I came from Geneva and arrived in Bangkok yesterday. Now, the last 10 years that I have stayed in Europe, I don't know whether this could be an indicator, but if you need something to indicate the differences in the way people are living at the moment, it's not only economic growth or just cost of living, but I have friends coming over many times, particularly from Asia, came to stay in Europe or just travel through Europe. Some of them told me that they have never had so many things stolen from them as they had while traveling through Rome, Paris, London. They have their things taken away from them at Heathrow Airport, their cars being broken into in Paris, pickpocketed in Rome. Where I live in Geneva, in a condominium, there are several units in that condominium that have been broken into several times in a year. This is in Geneva, supposed to be one of the safest places in Europe. Now, I don't want to compare this to other places in the world, but you compare this to Asia. Many friends told me that things like this do not normally happen in Asia. There was one recent article in Financial Times, just a couple of weeks ago. There was a guy who writes about traveling. And he was in Bangkok a couple months ago. And he was traveling on this BTS, the train. And he noticed small girls in uniform, school uniform, traveling together in a group on their own on the train. And he was writing this article saying that nowhere else in the world has he seen so many young, these are young girls, school uniform, traveling on their own in public transportation. So he wrote this article and saying that, of course, things in Bangkok must be quite safe. Of course, we know that there are places that are safe and places that are less safe. But I'm telling you this story just to demonstrate the impact. That while we are saying that US is really beginning to show some life in its economy, Europe is beginning to turn around, I don't buy into all these stories very much. I think the danger that we are seeing at the moment is that somebody will be moving to believe in these things too soon, because when they see some blips, one swallow doesn't a summer make. One blip in 1 month of some positive figures on employment or joblessness or whatever, the PMI index or consumer confidence, doesn't mean that things will be improving in Europe and United States. So I would wish you to compare the things so well. It remains a basic fact, and this is true with whoever I talk to at the World Bank or IMF or in Geneva, in New York, that Asia is still the place where growth is going to be. This is still the place. You talked about consumption. We talk about people in China need to consume more, domestic demand must be enhanced, in Thailand the same thing. You look at the consumption of wine, for example. There are French wine companies that are now just investing more and more for their distribution network in Asia. Because in Europe, people are consuming less and less wine per head every year. And in Asia, per head, wine consumption is increasing. Maybe not a good indication, but it says something about the way people are going to consume more in Asia. Why chateaus in France are being bought up by the Chinese? My French friends are very worried. They said they may be buying to do something else with the chateau, not to produce wine. So whoever knows what they will do. But anyway, they are buying up things like this in Europe. And so it's a sort of a ongoing sales in Europe of assets. When banks are forced by Basel III to increase their equity ratio, the capital asset ratios. And they cannot do it now. As you know, banks in Europe are not in their last throes, but they're not in very good shape. And they cannot increase their equity capital. So now selling their assets just to reduce their asset. So if you talked about rebalancing in Asia, particularly in China, in India, in Southeast Asia, this is, I would say, a much needed rebalancing. Even without the global economic slowdown, China will need to rebalance. Southeast Asia will need to restructure. And India may need to be thinking of their own imbalances. Rebalancing in China is influenced by a few things, as you know. First, of course, by the global economic slowdown. Secondly, by the need for their own domestic economies to be more equitable in the way they produce growth for various parts of China. And third, because of the need for China to be more efficient, in the way they produce things. Because the growth rate in the past has been growth rate, yes. But growth of 10%, 12% doesn't mean much. If you use a lot of capital, if you use a lot of investment, cheap savings, use a lot of subsidies, a lot of misallocation, a lot of excess capacity. So the time has come now for China to be addressing all these issues. And so you have now the new leadership that I happen to know them a little bit. Actually, I know them both, President Xi Jinping and Premier Li Keqiang from way before. Now, particularly Premier Li, I don't know whether you know, but a few years ago, when he was a deputy prime minister, he was the one who was very courageous in encouraging the, I think it's called Development Research Center of the State Council of China, to engage themselves with a major research on the future of China with the World Bank of all people, with the World Bank economists. And as you know, World Bank economists are always very critical of China. But Premier Li, when he was vice premier, he encouraged this research institution under the State Council to do this report. And the report was launched last year, before he became the premier. It was launched in 2012. The report is called China 2030. It talks about harmonizing and balancing and all this sort of thing. But the report does really indicate his ideas, how to approach China 20 years from now, why China will be in need of more efficiency, to be restructuring the state-owned enterprises, to be using less subsidies, to be doing less stimulus using cheap bank loans that have been misallocated because the savings have been so cheaply mobilized from the people around China. So this is really basically also the leadership process that is driving China in that direction. Now, the impact on the rest of us, you cannot look only at the, let's say, the potential decline in the long-term growth rate in China. Of course, China's will have to come down from decades of 10% on average to a decade of 7% on average and another decade of 5% on average. These are things that happened in the past with other countries around the world, and we have seen this happen in Japan, for example, in the 60s and 70s. Now, this will have implication for countries in Southeast Asia, for sure, and particularly on Thailand, on CLMV, particularly those countries that depend so much on the so-called value chain. When Thailand and Vietnam will have to produce things and sell into the Chinese manufacturing conundrum, this will have implication. When countries will have to sell a lot of commodities to China, like Indonesia, it will have implication because China will become more resource efficient. But when countries are more dependent on investment from China, like I would say Cambodia, Laos, and Myanmar, they would be enjoying the benefit because the Chinese manufacturers and also foreign investors in China are now, or have been always, have in the past few years, been making plans and moving things, relocating investment away from China already, into Southeast Asia, into partly into Thailand, but mainly into Cambodia, maybe Vietnam, also in Laos, where they have a lot of investment from China. So in terms of investment, you can see our report from the UN show last year that China, for a change, first time, that the FDI flow into China fell by 3%. I thought this year, the first half of this year, the inflow would increase. No, but it dropped again by more than 10%. But inflows of FDIs into CLMV countries, into Southeast Asia, has been on the increase. So the trends are not always that when we do adjustment and rebalancing, that this will be for the worse. I think we have to look at more a long-term trend, that this is a necessary path of countries in Southeast Asia and in Asia as a whole to adjust themselves. It depends on how they structurally adjust themselves to meet the new requirements that we are seeing around Asia. And I would certainly like to look forward that the new rounds of growth in China, in Asia, in Southeast Asia, in ASEAN will be growth with more quality, with more equality, with more inclusiveness.
Thank you. I think that's a good start. I guess I'll ask and open a question about the relationship of China in relation to the US and Japan. Yeah?
Yes.
There's been some observers that say that perhaps Thailand's policy is rather China-centric. You know, there's given that, I guess when you look at say President Obama came last year and has invited I think Thailand to join as part of the TPP, Trans-Pacific Partnership Agreement. But I guess in recent months the signals that that Thailand is perhaps not as keen. Japan has invited, opened the possibility of an FTA with Thailand, but I think Thailand doesn't want to send a wrong signal to China. So I guess there's a rivalry that's going on between the US, Japan, which is a big FDI investor in China, and actually even though China has picked up, the FDI from Japan is 20 times larger from China from Japan than China. So I was wondering how do you see this playing out? Is there a chance that picking sites and would strain some relationships with certain partners and so on?
Yep. There are now three major regional integration efforts ongoing in the world today. Three major efforts. One which is called the TPP, Trans-Pacific Partnership. Another one which is called TTIP, Trans-Atlantic Trade and Investment Partnership between US and EU. And the third one is the RCEP, the Regional Comprehensive Economic Partnership, which is basically ASEAN plus six. These are three major efforts at regional integration. TPP is a so-called 21st century regionalism, meaning that the agenda that the likes of the US would have liked to push through the World Trade Organization to the so-called Doha development agenda, which is still ongoing after 12 years, they could not succeed. They would like to see, a deeper treatment of intellectual property rights. They don't want to see exemptions on parallel importing, on compulsory licensing, for example. They want the life of the pipeline protection to be extended beyond 10 years, 15 years, 20 years. This is all they want. They want labor rights to be included in trade agreements, for example. They want environment protection to be part of the trade agreement and all this sort of thing. So they couldn't have pushed that through the World Trade Organization. So they're looking through the TPP as a place where they can launch the kind of US agenda on Asia. And they say this is the way US wants to be involved in Asia, but it's mainly launching US agenda in Asia. I'm not so sure, they have 29 chapters in the TPP, 29 chapters for negotiation, 29 chapters in the TPP. At the moment, I've been told that they have about 15 of them. Just a few days ago, I think it was in Brunei or Malaysia, I'm not so sure, they were having their 15 negotiation rounds, and a lot of countries have problems. I mean, Australia has major problem with the state and companies dispute settlement, because Australia cannot have that when companies will sue the states because there's some violations to the agreements. Malaysia has tremendous problem with the state-owned enterprises treatment. Same as Vietnam. Japan would have a lot of escape clauses needed. People are saying that TPP membership US would be pleased to have Japan join, but I'm not so sure. Japan would delay the completion of TPP by years because there will be a lot of escape clauses for Japan that will have to be discussed, particularly in the areas of agriculture. So for me, TPP is something which is maybe an interesting exercise. I'm not so sure whether Thailand should be joining or not joining, but I don't see TPP as sorting out the global trade problems at the moment. But it would impose a lot of new rules and regulations on countries in Asia and in South America. And I don't know whether the universal health care that is going to be practiced in Thailand will be served by being membership of the TPP, for example. TTIP, the Transatlantic Trade and Investment Partnership, has been discussed for decades between US and EU. It's been an EU push just last year that President Obama agreed to, but mainly the TTIP would be handling not the tariff issues, because tariffs between US and EU is just basic minimum. It's just close to zero anyway. But the thing is that they need to harmonize their rules. Their rules on government procurement, their rules on competition laws, their rules on geographical indications, all sort of rules between US and EU, it's so much different. They said it will take 2 years to complete that. I can say it will take at least 5 to 10 years if it would ever be completed at all. There'll be so vast differences. Just pick up one area of geographical indications. The protection of names of ham, of, I don't know, of wine, of drinks, and of cheeses. All these other things will take years for them to agree upon. So I don't think it will be completed soon. Should TPP and TTIP be completed soon, I don't think whether the global trading regime will be served, because there will be another alternative, the WTO, to the original WTO, because these two agreements would set up new rules and regulations that are very high order, and this will impose on the rest of the world, which I'm not joining in all this discussion. And they may be forced and obliged to join into these rules, which they may not be able to comply with, because it's so way, way above. It's a 21st century rule. So this is going to take away the kind of multilateral framework that the WTO has been having oversight over. It's not really a very positive sign. Now, the competing regional integration of regional comprehensive economic partnership, the RCEP, the ASEAN plus six. Now, that is something that is more mundane. It doesn't have the lofty goals of trying to realign and harmonize all the rules and regulations. It would deal with the issues basically of tariff reduction, market access. It would deal with the issues of infrastructure. It would deal with the issues of regional public goods like the grid and energy grid, the waterways, infrastructure, investment, telecommunications, things that can help Asia to be better supported, to have better economic development cooperation that would help to make efficiency and market mechanism work better. So here we can see different efforts, and I don't know whether countries like Thailand or some of the four or five countries in ASEAN, whether they will join TPP at the same time trying to make headways with the RCEP. At the moment, it's such a sad thing that there's been somewhat of a lull in the way of stalemate in the way that relationship between China, Japan, Korea, and some of the ASEAN member countries have been put on the back burner, because if we would have been able to walk the path of RCEP for a bit longer, this may have helped for these countries to be looking at their economic and political relationship in a better light. I used to hear from friends in China that all this problem exists for decades, long ago. But when we discuss economic prosperity, when we discuss economic cooperation, we would push this in the background, the sideline, and try to make new rules and regulations so that people will enjoy the benefits. And so I'm still hopeful, because at the level of ministries, of ministerial discussion, still there are efforts between all these countries that seem to be in conflict, China, Japan, Korea, ministers are still talking as to how they can approach the asset that has been launched last year in Phnom Penh. But of course, it's really unfortunate that at the level of the leaders, they are not really meeting yet on the topics of asset at the moment.
Thank you. I guess on that, perhaps we can move to the ASEAN Economic Community. You know, that's Target 2015. Your assessment, your views on the progress so far, because I think a lot of the plans for Thailand, I mean, Thailand is right at the center, seem to be the big beneficiary of the AAC, especially in terms of the infrastructure connectivity. But yet, at the same time, a lot of countries seem to be falling behind in terms of the targets. What's your sense?
Well, the AEC is certainly going to be a very important and important exercise for all the ASEAN 10 countries. For Thailand, the likes of Indonesia, it will be a means to be able to reach the kind of economies of scale. One of my dreams for ASEAN Economic Community is to be able to relocate some of the global value chain from being linked to somewhere in the globe, with the US, EU, or with China, or somewhere else, to be more and more owned by ASEAN companies. We can see this in automotive industry. You can see this in medical equipment industry. We can see this in some of the pharmaceutical industries, that different steps in the value chain could be brought together more when we can enhance economy of scale in ASEAN Economic Community. We can see rules and regulations that could be more enhanced. People are working on, for example, on competition laws that we are helping from Geneva. Competition laws will be needed for countries to be investing, merging, taking over different other companies in a way that they can become more competitive. And they should be facilitated and not blocked. When AEC is going to provide for a larger market, people should be allowed to move everywhere in ASEAN and to be doing merger and acquisition on a more competitive and equitable basis. So we need to have a harmonization of the commission rules. I do see for AEC that movements of people, human resources, they might start with, I don't know, 7 different professions. But I hope that the movement, mobility of natural resource of skilled manpower should be fully opened up. So that because of the scarce resources, human resource in ASEAN, that could be solved. Because at the moment, Thailand should be looking now to go less and less into labor-intensive industries. Thailand should leave labor-intensive industries to the likes of Cambodia and Laos and maybe Vietnam and Myanmar, and which is what's happening. I talked to several Japanese investors who are moving their investment away from Thailand, not because they dislike Thailand, no. They are trying to upgrade Thailand into the level that would involve a more sophisticated chain in their global value chain, more research-based, more distribution-based chain, more marketing chains, more design chains. And they move the labor-intensive parts into Cambodia, into Laos, which is happening, which is a good thing for Thailand. And so this is I would say, the process that AEC can help to expedite. The efficiency in which we would have a wider market, more economy of scale, better harmonization of rules and regulation, more mobility of capital, and capital is not yet very mobile, but I do see that there will be better rules and regulation and more harmonization of the rules in listing around ASEAN, for example. Hopefully, there will be new arrangement on the Chiang Mai initiative. You see, the Chiang Mai initiative, which was created during my time when we were suffering from the last financial crisis in Asia in 1997, 1998, should be multilateralized, which is being done. They put up, I think, $250 billion, which nobody uses. The Chiang Mai initiative is something which is commended around the world. We use a lot of that, an example, to do the same thing in Latin America. But this Chiang Mai initiative, which is a pooling of funds, which could help to establish more stability in the way currency could be traded around Asia, has not been used. Why? Because there are so many conditionalities attached to that. And the ultimate conditionality is that you have to seek approval from the IMF. This is an agreement among all these countries, and I don't know why. So what they have to do in terms of having capital mobility, advancement of the ASEAN-wide or Asian-wide bond markets and things like that, and to have certain codes of conduct, to be looking at currency movement, codes of conduct. Currency movement in the case of ASEAN and ASEAN plus 10 should be dealt with in a way that countries should be able to have some sort of a surveillance so that we would be able to avoid the so-called bigger than neighbor policies. We should not do that in Asia. And through this AEC, I do hope that a likelihood of an Asian monetary fund could be brought about. And this was some old idea that was shot down because the US, EU, and Japan didn't like it. And now even EU, who objected to the Asian Monetary Fund in 1997, now they're doing their own European Monetary Fund without calling it. They call it a financial stability mechanism or something like that. European financial stability. This is in all things but name, that's the same as European Monetary Fund. So I think Asia will have to do the same thing. I don't think Asia would have this false dream of having more leverage, more control in the IMF. Never. Nobody, US and EU, would not give them this kind of a leverage on the IMF. Never. So the only thing they can do is to have their own leverage on their sources of income, a source of capitals. And that is plenty in Asia. And that should be something that should be instigated and created through the launching of AEC. The launching of AEC in 2015, whether it's beginning of 2015 or end of 2015, doesn't matter very much. Nothing will happen much in 2016 because they say that we have done 70%, 75% of what's supposed to be. Less than that has been done. Less than that has been done. Countries around ASEAN has been trying to put up already several obstacles ahead of 2015. For example, it's a non-tariff barriers. In some countries, I won't name names. For example, when you export things to some other countries in ASEAN, you're supposed to export it, let's say, to the major port in the country. Now people are saying, look, we have so many ports, we want to use all the ports, so we export your food to all these ports around the country, but not to the major ports. We are saying different things about non-tariff barriers in a way that custom procedures have not been really harmonized in ASEAN. How can you have an ASEAN economic community without really harmonizing the custom procedures? Well, so a lot of things will have to happen, but it is a good thing to start launching it because it will be an external force that would oblige all these countries to harmonize their rules and to be more efficient in the way they manage their economic policies.
Thank you, Dr. Supachai. I think we can perhaps open up for questions from the audience.
We have microphones on the floor, so if there's any questions for Dr. Supachai, please. Here you go. Can you state your name, sir, please?
Sorry. Paul Gamble from MBMG. I was very interested to hear your comments about China, and a lot of people are saying very similar stories. We all realize fixed asset formation can't go on. We've got to reform government. It's great that you know these people. It's great that they are committed, but nobody's really been able to describe for me how we get from where we are now to where we want to be in China. And every sort of example in history I can think of suggests that it's going to be a very painful transition. The best sort of admissions I can get from people is, yes, there'll be volatility. But I think that's really brushing probably one of the biggest changes that we're going to see in our lifetimes under the carpet. I think there's going to be an awful lot of trauma and drama. How do you see us actually getting from where China is now to where China needs to be, whether it's under this leadership or another leadership? It'll have to happen. And, we haven't really talked about what impact that's going to have on places like Thailand or ASEAN. I see this as possibly being the biggest economic event we all face. And I think there's some pretty rough times going to come before we get to the good times.
Well, I mean, there have always been rough times in Europe. You look the way UK used to tap into the IMF rescue operations in the 70s. Rough time for Europe to be adjust. There'll be more rough time in Europe for them to adjust. There've been rough time in Japan. They've gone through nearly two decades of non-growth, for example. There'll be rough time, yes, now, in the future, for the world economy, because I don't see any new locomotive coming up to be able to pull this global economy into the same speed, and maybe we don't need that same speed of growth like in the past. But in China, a few things happening, small things maybe, for example, in the areas of banking. I know the quality of banking in China leaves a lot to be desired. But at least at the moment, there are definite plans to allow more private banks to participate in China's system. There are plans to allow more liberalization. For example, interest rates for savings has been so much under control. Savers have been paid so little in China, so they are bound to be paid more, and so there'll be costs to the borrowers at the market rate, so that the kind of excessive investment basically misallocated because of the cheap cost of loans are going to be eliminated. So through the banking system, I do hope, and maybe all of us should be mentioning this to China as so often, as we are now trying to do, that you have to really reform the banking system to make it more efficient, to make banking system less state control, because all these borrowings will go mainly into the state-owned enterprises. And the SMEs, the small one, they have to go to, I don't know what kind of non-bank activities, which is very expensive. So this is one key area which I know this Chinese leadership is now undertaking, and I know this is one area in which we can see that this will involve do something better for China. I do see that China looks also at TPP. China looks also at TPP. Without even the TPP putting pressure on China to do something to their state-owned enterprises, China will have to do something to their own state-owned enterprises anyway. And at the moment, I do see in the areas of services, because we're working with the Chinese government in the area of services. Services in China accounts now only for 40% of that GDP, which is way below the kind of weight that China can give to services, because they can't be more efficient if their services, energy, communication, education, health, it cannot be more efficient. So China is trying to lift the services participation from 40% to 50% in that 12-5-year plan. And we're working with them. We have created now an annual just alternative to the Canton Fair. You see, Canton Fair has been around with us for, I don't know, 30, 40 years. Now we have created another fair, which is on services in Beijing. And this is introducing not only the kinds of exhibition of ITC companies around China, but to every year to have a monitoring system on how China is liberalizing, freeing up the services sector for China's own benefit. They know they need this services sector to enhance their own benefit. We are seeing China's real effort to diversify their economies away from the eastern coast. I travel with Chinese leaders and friends to Jilin in the north to work on the so-called the Greater Tumen region, linking China with Korea, the two Koreas and Russia. I travel with them to Xinjiang to see the process they are linking the western part of China with Central Asia. I did a lot of work on GMS, the Greater Mekong Sub-region, and Guangxi region, Nanning in southern part, Yunnan, linking up with the rest of Southeast Asia. So you're seeing really growth rate in all these regions going through 10%, beyond 10%, while the eastern coast is below 10%. So there is distribution and redistribution going on in China that would help to address the imbalances that we've talked about so much. You can see the way that China's export performance. China export used to be something like 40% of that GDP. It's now less than 30%. The current account surplus in China used to be 9%, 2008, 9% of GDP. It's now 2% and less than 2% going on. So there are structural adjustments going on in China, for sure. But you can't wish it. It's just like a huge tanker moving around in the ocean. It would take days before they can just turn. For China, it would take years. But we have to keep moving. China's investment at the moment, inward investment into China is 110 billion every year, the largest, except for the US. Now China is doing the outbound investment of about 80 to 90 billion every year. So China has become, I think, the third or second largest FDI investors as well. So they are moving away and they are trying to adjust themselves. They are buying companies around the world so that they can be more technology savvy. They're doing this. And that for me indicates a kind of structural change which the rest of Asia, particularly ASEAN, should try to analyze. Because we couldn't go on the same spree of China being export-oriented as before. and to be basing our industries on the commodities, things like it. Indonesia, we have really to adjust their own economy, because the way Indonesia has been growing the last 5 years, basing that with their trade with China on the commodity trade, cannot go on. Commodity prices will go into a new cycle of a long-term slowdown. Prices, unlike in the last 5 years, where there was an upcycle of commodities, because now China is going to be more efficient there. And so Thailand certainly will have to make adjustment. I said about the global value chain. The value chain that that Thailand has been involved with China will have to change. We depend so much on the chain in China that we need to be looking more at ASEAN and owning our own chain. And there are several areas in Thailand that we could undertake that.
Maybe I'll pick up that issue about the China's outward FDI. You know? I think one of the observations made was that China investment, FDI into ASEAN, is actually pretty small, remarkably small. In fact, Africa attracts several times the amount that ASEAN gets from China. Thailand, I believe the figure from China is something less than 2 billion in comparison to Japan, which is over like 41 billion. So it's a question of why hasn't we seen more of China FDI coming into ASEAN? A second question is, I think when you look at the composition, 90% of that China FDI is actually from state-owned enterprises. Is there a strategic reason, or is that something to be concerned about? I guess Ong Tuck is the authority on FDI.
Yeah, China's outward FDIs are still based on the search for commodities. They invest heavily in Africa. They're the second largest foreign investors in Africa after the United States, but mainly driven by their search for commodities, particularly oil, copper, iron ores, minerals. Yes, they are doing some processing, but very little. Besides investing in mineral exploitation, they invest heavily in the infrastructural construction in Africa. They do a lot of construction of roads, bridges, convention center, hospitals in Africa. They're now doing more work in the areas of agriculture. And we are monitoring them. We advise China in the past on the inbound investment into China. Now Chinese are more concerned with the outbound investment. So we are working with the Chinese as to how to structure their outbound investment that could benefit China, but also could benefit the recipient countries. And this is something that ASEAN and China should be looking at, and to be working in along the line that we've been seeing, let's say, infrastructure investment. The roads that would link, for example, China, the rails and rail links and the road links through Laos into Thailand, China into Myanmar, the gas pipeline that has been in operation this year, the oil pipeline, these are all investment that China will be doing mainly to link China with the sources of commodities. And of course, the new deep sea port that China is building, this is going to be in competition with the one that Thailand is initiating in Davao. This is one which is a bit above the Davao, which is going to be a huge tanker port for major Chinese tankers to come from Africa with huge amount of oil to pipe that into I think it's called Geopio or something like that port, and to be piped through Myanmar into China. So all this are linked with the Chinese need for commodities. And this is one area in which China will have to address, is to be more efficient in the way they consume energy and consume resources. Because like this in the past, they're going to exhaust resources around the world. So this is something that they have to do. But with the kind of regional integration in ASEAN, ASEAN plus six, we can take benefits of all these issues. Thailand, for example, can really position ourselves as a hub. And Thailand is really, in geographic term, a hub already. But Thailand is not a hub in terms of custom procedures. Thailand is not a hub in terms of logistics. Because all these inefficiencies at the borders and the rules and regulations that are excessive, things like that, this is something which is not materialist. It's not physical. It's more legal. It's more rule-based. Governance, things like that Thailand will have to improve.
Thank you. Perhaps we can take a few more questions.
Again, if you can just state your name, thank you.
Good Good morning. I'm Karma Wilson from HSBC Global Asset Management. I just want to talk a bit about the opportunity that we are constantly hearing about Thailand and its interconnectivity. And I attended this conference last year as well and heard much about that. So yesterday we heard about changing the gauge track to interconnect to both China and all the way down to Singapore. You've mentioned the Dawei port, the east-west corridor. There are plenty of opportunities, and especially for Thailand, because it's a very good business environment, but it doesn't have the demographic dividend that you see in many countries in ASEAN. So to interconnect would be highly beneficial. But I guess as cynical investors, we keep waiting to see what that will happen. What are the necessary conditions? We need to see this change from opportunity to reality. And I think you also just touched on some of the low-hanging fruit that can be done. And I know last year at the conference, we heard about these border constraints you just mentioned. The CIQ shuts at 10 p.m. It doesn't open again until 6 a.m. It would be very simple to pay a bit of overtime and get that addressed. At this point in time, does CIQ operate 24 hours? You know, can we see the actual will, the initiative that's going to be needed to realize all the potential here?
Thank you so much for asking this question. I mean, I'm sure you may better put this question to our Deputy Prime Minister, Kittirat. But I will pass it on to Khun Kittirat anyway. There are two things. I think the first thing is that in Thailand, and for me looking from outside into Thailand, I think we tend to be involved in the wrong issues, in the wrong questions. For example, when we discuss infrastructural plans, we spend 90% of the time discussing the 2 trillion, what is it, the 2 trillion baht, the borrowing schemes of the government, instead of discussing the priorities of the schemes and how are we going to really implement some of the basic things. I mean, we spend a whole bunch of time discussing whether it's good or not to have 2 trillion and now and future and the debt burden and everything. It's not going to be like that. There's not going to be any debt burden on Thailand because we are not going to do all these things. It's not going to happen. Because we've talked like this, it's not because of this government. In governments many years ago when I was involved, we talked about double track, we talked about speed train, we talked about linking China to Chiang Mai to Thailand. It's all been talked, it's been more than 15 years ago, 20 years ago. I think we've been always in Thailand missing the real issues. I mean, the issue is that we have to pick just one track. Maybe finishing this fourth bridge across the Mekong River into Laos. How are we going to make use of these roads and rail links that come through China into Laos, into Thailand? Just pick up on one thing like that. And maybe the other one, the road linking through Myanmar, just a few things, and make it work. Because I don't see the preparations for the Thai civil servants to be really seriously involved with all these things. Feasibility studies, yes, yet to be done. You can ask TDI about it, because TDI will give you the real things. If it's not yet done, then how are you to move it? They've done something on some of the things, but not on all the things. Speed train, you know, I mean, even in England, they are now rethinking linking the speed train between Heathrow into London. This has been a long-term plan in London. Now rethinking it because the costs are so much that it's become less feasible. So Thailand may have to really have feasible plans that people can discuss, not the borrowing spree and this sort of thing. The second one is the issue of governance. Really, I mean, if you talk about GMS, I am one of the founding fathers of GMS 20 years ago. 20 years ago, all the GMS members have signed up on the protocol, transport protocol, to make use of all these corridors, except for Thailand. Except for Thailand. How are we going to talk about infrastructure linkages and part of Thailand if you don't even want to sign on the protocol, which even Laos, Cambodia, everybody has signed, China included, Myanmar, except for Thailand. And why hasn't Thailand signed? You can ask the Thai government. And it's not only this government, but governments, they don't sign. And sometimes they said, the security issue. I said, well, it's what security? I don't know. So the governance issue and the implementation are basically two issues that I still think that we always miss the point when we discuss things in Thailand. Economic issues are dealt with in some areas which seem to be loaded with a lot of political maneuverings and not really economic substance.
Okay.
guess time's running short. Maybe I'll take the liberty of asking the last question. We've been getting a lot of questions, I guess given what's happening in India, Indonesia, whether, you know, we're in for some kind of crisis in ASEAN, in Thailand, and given that you lived through the Asian crisis, what's your take that what's different this time, and perhaps we can reassure the audience?
I'm really very concerned with India. I tend to like India, a special country for me. I tend to like India a lot. I have friends there. Prime Minister Manmohan Singh has been great friends for a long, long time, and I know the intention of people like Manmohan Singh and Chidambaram, the finance ministers. India is full of good intentions, but India, they used to call India the kind of license rat in the past. It's still very cumbersome to do business in India. And India, if India is not really, if you talk about reform in China, you need tremendous, massive reforms in India, many times over compared to China. It's not only railways and roads and everything, but in terms of the way governments are subsidizing things around India. It's really a case which is not only reflective through the depreciation of the rupee. It's been, when India was less buoyant, I go there a lot and support India, particularly the investment in infrastructure. I used to have friends in there. Kamal Nath has been a friend who's just promised to me every day he will build I don't know how many kilometers of roads. And it cannot be done because there are no, you know that 5 or 6 government agencies in India that are involved with infrastructure. And they keep changing people all around. So when they rotate everything, it's another year. So nothing has happened there. So India is really a case that is really worrying. And I do hope that people can really move India forward. They are now doing better in terms of food security in India. They are producing more food. They have actually begun to invest more in agriculture. They are trying to do more in terms of their own financial reforms, particularly in the insurance sector, which is doing far better than before. But the rest is still very much a license raj kind of management. And they have to be more competitive. So the way they're working at the moment, they cannot really easily deal with the issues of their current account deficit. Indonesia is a case where this can be a great economy. Why? Because it has a good balance between domestic consumption and export-oriented economy. Indonesia's size, population, is a kind of size that can justify huge investment into, let's say, maybe steel industries, into more manufacturing, and into commodity-based productions. But of course, again, Indonesia cannot rely too much on commodities-driven economy. Indonesia has to move away from that and like Thailand, try to make use of their commodities to link more into more processing. And Indonesia will have also to work on their own governance, like we all do in Asia, in ASEAN, the corruption thing. One of the things which is so good for AEC is that we're going to have a sort of a scorecard on governance, CSR scorecard for all the ASEAN. And I do hope they are serious with it. And you should be trying to look at that, because this is something that ASEAN and ASEAN economic community should be doing that to try to make sure that all these countries in ASEAN gets their scorecard on the CSR, on corruption, on governance, to the level which probably not at the level of Singapore, but coming closer instead of moving downwards all the time. This is really, if you look at the Transparency International Corruption Index, it's really a desolate, a sad place for some of our colleagues in ASEAN. I do see that this is an important thing. It's not only growth of just balancing and reform in physical terms, but the institutional term, that is something that we really badly need for the future.
Any words on the Thailand and in terms of the...
Well, I can't say much on Thailand because I don't think I know so much about Thailand compared to what the Deputy Prime Minister just said yesterday. And I think we need to be less complacent. That is, we Thais seem to be easygoing, as you can see. And I hope that the Thais could be more serious when we discuss things that you're not seeing yet. But you see it's coming. You see things, like you see the lights coming. People can say, oh, it's just some other lights, but it might be the train coming from the other side, you see. And we don't have to wait until the train hit us so that we would be complaining. In the last few years, we've been exploiting, excessively benefiting from all the QEs, all the stimulus measures and money coming in without us doing anything. That is an illusion. I mean, for the stock prices index from Thailand to move from 1,200 to 1,600 and now back to 1, it just because 80% has been driven by money from outside. This is not the real thing from Thailand. So when people say things are going on well in Thailand, I think I don't want to be self-critical so much, but I think we better be serious with what we're seeing at the moment. That if you say that because we really have the substance, let's see whether the substance will show. Because if the substance is there, we don't need to worry about this tapering off of all these QEs in the world. I don't think QEs can be tapered off so easily. Because like I said from the outset, from the beginning, I don't see economic recovery taking on full steam in United States, neither in Europe, far, far behind in Europe. So, and we should not be counting on the prolongation of the way the advanced economies are putting huge amounts of liquidity into the international market so that we can live happily. No, we should be doing our own work to generate our own demand, where the investment sector oriented, real sector benefiting from liquidity and not really just being floated around because of the price of papers are going up, whether in equity or bonds or whatever. We need to have the real things, and real things are to be found in more research, more innovations, better education that are oriented towards the linkages between education, innovation, research, and commercial undertakings. These are things that we need to do. And implementation, not just discussion on where we are going to get the money. Money is the least of all importance in Thailand, or in Southeast Asia for that matter. But the real absorptive capacity, the real capacity of our human resource to implement on this is really questionable. And you can discuss the 2 trillion and infrastructure plans forever ad nauseum, ad infinitum. Mm-hmm. It's not going to happen, not in the next couple of years, because we don't have the capacity to do that. I have seen it 50 years, 20 years ago. How are we going to change so rapidly in the next few years? We must do that. And we should all encourage and try to see to it that we have governments and people who move around things and really talk about the real issue, and not to be talking about all the side issues that are not really materialist, material for the real change in the country.
Okay. I think our time's up. Thank you, Dr. Supachai, for the very engaging session.
Thank you very much for a lively and informative session from Dr. Supachai and Dr. Hakbin.